हेलो फ्रेंड्स, सो टिल नाउ वी सॉ द रिवीजन ऑफ नंबर सिस्टम्स, ओके, एक्सपोनेंट्स, एलजेब्रिक आइडेंटिटीज, पॉलीनोमियल्स. नाउ वील स्टार्ट लीनियर इक्वेशन इन टू वेरिएबल्स. ओके, सो लीनियर इक्वेशंस इन टू वेरिएबल्स. So linear equation two variables is a standard form. Its standard form is ax plus by plus c equal to 0. Okay, here a and b should not be equal to 0 simultaneously. That means anyone can be 0, but both should not be 0 at the same time. Now in this chapter we'll see that which type of questions might be asked. The very first question we can say that you will get a linear equation in single variable. However, this concept is related to the 8, but sometimes these questions are also asked in the exam. So something like this, you may get the question, this is 2x minus 3 is equal to 5 multiplied by 2x plus 7. Then you have to find the value of x. That means simply you have to know that how to solve the linear equation in one variable. So let us see its solution. Is 2x minus 6 is equal to 10x plus 35. Okay, so 2x minus 10x is equal to 35 plus 6. So minus 8x is equal to 41. So x is equal to 41 upon 8 with negative sign. So in this type of question you may get that in which you have to find the value of one single variable. Okay. This is the first type of question. Next, one equation will be given to you and it was asked to find the solutions of the equation. Okay, how to get the solution of the equation? For example, we have equation 2x plus 3y is equal to 6. So we have to find the different solution. Now, very first thing, that it's a linear equation in one variable, so it has infinitely many solutions. Solution means those values of x and y which when we put in the equation, it gets satisfied. For example, if I put x equal to 0 and y equal to 2, so here it will be 2 into 0 plus 3 into 2, so 0 plus 6, and on the right hand side again I am getting 6. So I can say 0 comma 2 is the solution of the equation. Okay, so the question is that find the different solutions. Okay, or which of the following is the solution of the equation? So in case, what we have to do, how to find the solution, let us see. We'll take let x equal to 0. We can take the value of any one variable by our own, and by putting that value in the equation and by solving it, we'll get the value of second variable. Okay, so here x equal to 0, so this gives me 2 into 0 plus 3y is equal to 6. Okay, 2 into 0 plus 3y is equal to 6. So this gives me 3y is equal to 6, y is equal to 2. So I will say 0 comma 2 is a solution. Okay, so we can find infinite solution. I will give you one or two solutions. Generally what we'll do, we'll start with x equal to 0, then in next solution we'll take y equal to 0. Let y equal to 0. So I will get 2x plus 3 into 0 is equal to 6, that is 2x is equal to 6, so x is equal to 3. Even though I kept the value of y and I obtained the value of x, but whenever I have to write the solution, I do write the value of x first and then I have to write the value of y. So 3 comma 0 is the solution of the given equation. You can check it. If you put x equal to 3 and y equal to 0, left hand side and right side will be satisfied. Now see, on putting x equal to 0, I got y equal to 2. So the only restriction is that to get the next solution, I can't take y equal to 2. Even though if I take y equal to 2, I will get x equal to 0 and the solution remains same. So that you have to take care that you do not repeat the values. For example, on putting y equal to 0, I got x equal to 3. That means over here I won't put x equal to 3. Again, I am saying even though if I put x equal to 3, that y will be 0 only. Okay, so this is the way to get the solutions. Now, next type of question in this particular chapter, that one of the solution will be given to you and they will ask the value of unknown. For example, question is like that: if 2 comma minus 5 is a solution of is a solution of 4x minus 3y plus k is equal to 0, then find the value of k. So what, see, 2 comma minus 5 is the solution. That means on putting x equal to 2 and y equal to minus 5, equation should get satisfied. So as it's a solution, I do like this: 4 into 2 minus 3 into minus 5 plus k equal to 0. So 8 plus 15 plus k equal to 0. So k equal to minus 23. That's it. Okay, so if solution is given, we can replace x and y accordingly in the given equation. Okay, so how to find the solution, and if a solution is given, how to get the values of unknown. So these are the two type of question generally asked in this chapter. Now next, there are some question might be related to the graph. See, so for that you can take some notes that if I have x equal to 0, so I can write x equal to 0 is the equation of y-axis. Okay, y equal to 0 is the equation of x-axis. Okay, x equal to a, where a belongs to real number, is the equation of a line parallel to y-axis. Okay, x equal to something, it means parallel to y-axis. Similarly, y equal to b or a, whatever I write, doesn't matter, belongs to R, is the equation of a line parallel to x-axis. Okay, so these are the equations, and graph, you know how to draw. If a equation is given and it is asked to draw the graph, what you have to do, suppose we have a equation 2x plus or simply x plus y is equal to 7 for a while, and it is asked to find and draw its graph. Or suppose a graph is given and it is asked to identify the graph represents which equation. So what we have to do, first of all, we have to find minimum 2 or 3 solutions. So here, if I put x equal to 0, y will be 7. If I put y equal to 0, x will be 7. If I put x equal to 3, y will be 4. These are the solutions. Now, I hope you know how to plot these points on the graph paper. If you plot these points on the graph paper and if you join them, you will get the graph of the equation. Okay, so this is the way to draw the graph of the equation. Okay, this is x-axis, this is y-axis, and if you are literally asked to draw the graph, then you have to write the scale as well. Okay, so this is, this chapter also contains some word problems. Okay, some situations, different situations are given to you, and you have to get the solution for that. So we'll see one question related to that as well. Suppose question is let me take the question from book itself. Okay, angles are in the ratio 2 is to 3 is to 4. Angles of a triangle are in the ratio 2 is to 3 is to 4. Okay, these are the ratios of the angles 2 is to 3 is to 4, and they are asking to find the angle. So as the ratio is given, we can say angles are 2x, 3x and 4x. Also, these angles are of a triangle as it is given in the question. I can say their sum will be 180. Okay, so this gives you 9x is equal to 180, hence x will be 20. As x equal to 20, so first angle 2x will be 40 degree, this angle 3x will be 3 into 2, that is 60 degree, and but obvious the last fourth angle will be 80 degree. Okay, so these type of word problem you also may get this in this chapter. So it is all about linear equation in two variables. Now next we will see coordinate geometry. Okay, coordinate geometry is also not that much difficult topic. You need to learn some very basic theoretical portion. Coordinate geometry. Okay, so next we'll start coordinate geometry. Now in coordinate geometry we'll basically talk about the axis and the coordinates, x coordinate and y coordinate. Now these x coordinate and y coordinates have some special names, so try to get that names, then we'll continue this chapter. So very basic thing in the coordinate geometry is it is all about locating a point in a plane. That means we have two axes. First the horizontal is called x-axis and this vertical is called y-axis. Okay. This meeting point of x-axis and y-axis is called origin. These topics that you have to, this theory that is the very important in this chapter. Okay, now to locate x coordinate we'll start from the origin. Suppose we have to locate a point -2, 3 or 2, 3 for a while. Okay, I'm not talking about the magnitude 2, 3. I'm basically more concentrate on the sign. So x coordinate is positive as well as y coordinate is positive. Now to locate this point on this graph paper, I will start from the origin, that is 0. Now we know that the direction on our right hand side we considered as positive and the direction on our left hand side we are considering is negative. Similarly, when we move upwards we will consider it positive and when we move downwards we will consider it is negative. Here the point is 2, 3, both are positive. That means to reach the point 2 I have to move towards the right of the origin up to 2 units. For a while this is 2 units. Okay. Now to get the point 3, now I have to move upwards because it is positive. How many units? 3 units. So here I am writing this is 3, 2 and 1. So I will reach over here and hence I will say this point is the coordinate 2, 3. Now x coordinate and y coordinates have some special names. X coordinate is called abscissa and y coordinate is called the ordinate. Okay, x coordinate is called abscissa. X coordinate is called abscissa and y coordinate is called ordinate. Also we'll say abscissa is the perpendicular distance of point from y axis. Okay, perpendicular distance from y axis and this is the perpendicular distance from x axis. दे जनरली डू आस 3, -4 और 3, -5. इफ द कोऑर्डिनेट ऑफ अ पॉइंट आर 3, -5 देन विच इज द परपेंडिकुलर डिस्टेंस ऑफ द पॉइंट फ्रॉम एक्स एक्सिस. फ्रॉम एक्स एक्सिस परपेंडिकुलर डिस्टेंस इज वाई कोऑर्डिनेट, बट आई वॉन्ट राइट -5 बिकॉज इट्स अ डिस्टेंस, इट कैन नॉट बी नेगेटिव. सो माई आंसर विल बी 5. दैट मीन्स फॉर दिस पॉइंट परपेंडिकुलर डिस्टेंस ऑफ दिस पॉइंट फ्रॉम एक्स एक्सिस इज 5 एंड परपेंडिकुलर डिस्टेंस ऑफ दिस पॉइंट फ्रॉम वाई एक्सिस इज 3. इन अनदर वर्ड एप्सिसा ऑफ दिस पॉइंट इज 3 एंड ऑर्डिनेट ऑफ दिस पॉइंट इज -5. ओके, वेन वी आस्क ऑर्डिनेट और द एप्सिसा, डेफिनेटली वी हैव टू गिव द आंसर्स विथ साइन. बट इफ दे आस्किंग द डिस्टेंस देन इन दैट केस वील स्किप द साइन. ओके, सो दिस इज एक्स कोऑर्डिनेट, वाई कोऑर्डिनेट. ओके, नाउ नेक्स्ट थिंग, जनरली इन दिस चैप्टर दे टू आस्क दैट सम पॉइंट्स विल बी गिवन टू यू एंड दे विल आस्क यू एंड इन विच क्वाड्रेंट और इन विच एक्सिस द फॉलोइंग पॉइंट लाई. ओके, नाउ बिफोर आई मूव टू दैट लेट मी टेल यू द क्वाड्रेंट. सी हियर यू कैन सी दीज टू एक्सिस ए एक्स ई एस is the plural of axis. So these two axes, that is y-axis and x-axis, divides the plane into four parts, and these four parts are actually called the quadrants. If I start from this, so this is the first quadrant, second, third, and fourth. These are the four quadrants. Now, sine of the abscissa and ordinate in the first quadrant, both are positive. Okay, you can see x is positive, y is positive. Over here, x is negative, y is positive. Over here, both are negative, and over here, x is positive, y is negative. So, the very first thing that you should understand, the sign convention of the points or of the coordinates in different quadrants. First, second, third, fourth. Now, question may be asked that the following points lie in which quadrant directly. Now, let us see some examples. Suppose I give you point 2, -5. Okay, √3, -1, √3. Okay, 7, π. Okay, √2 upon √3, √11, -19. Now, what I have to identify in which quadrant these points will lie. First point, its x coordinate is positive, y coordinate is negative. X positive, y negative. X positive, y negative. That means this is will lie in the fourth quadrant. X positive, y negative. Now over here, √3, 1 - √3. Now, don't get confused. You are not required to get the value of root 3. The only thing that you know, the sign of the coordinate. Here root 3 is positive. So here I can say the x coordinate is positive. Okay. Now here it is 1 - √3. So you should understand one thing, very normal thing, that is 3 is greater than 1. Or in other word, 1 is less than 3. So root 1 is less than root 3. Okay. That means this root 3 is greater than this. So difference of these two, smaller minus greater, will be negative. The only thing that you have to understand that the y coordinate is negative, x coordinate is positive. So when x is positive, y is negative, the point lie in the fourth quadrant. Okay, now over here 7, π. Now again, whenever you see pi, you get mad. What to do? So be least bothered about the value. Just you have to take care about the sign. Both are positive, isn't it? 7 is positive, pi is positive. Both are positive. That means that will be in first quadrant. Now, again over here, √2 by √3. Now, what to do? Nothing. Just see the sign. It is positive. Here, 11 is smaller than 19. So, root 11 is smaller than root 19. That means this is again going to be negative. So, positive, negative. Again in the fourth quadrant. Okay, so this is the way to identify that in which particular quadrant which point will lie. Now it is quite possible that some points won't lie in any quadrant. It means they might lie on the x-axis or y. Okay, so we'll come to that, but before that, see, here they directly asked you that in which quadrant the given points will lie. Now the another way to ask the same thing is this. Suppose they will give you that a equal to 2, b equal to 1, c equal to 3. Then in which quadrant a minus b comma 2c minus 7 will lie, or 2a minus 2a plus b comma 7 minus or c square minus a will lie in that way. Okay, I gave you just one or two examples. There is an infinite possibilities to change the values of ABC as well as to change these expressions. Okay, the only thing is that this is one more way to ask you that in which quadrant particular point will lie. Previously we saw directly the value were given. Over here you have two options. So A minus B. So 2 minus 1, that is positive. 2 minus 1 is 1, positive. 2C minus C. 2 is 6. 2 into 3 is 6. 6 minus 7, minus 1. So positive and negative. Again in the fourth quadrant. Okay. Now this 2A plus B, that is 4 plus 1, that is positive. Now C square minus A, C square is 9, okay, C is 3, so 9 minus 2 is 7, that is again positive. We are just concerned about the sign of the coordinate, doesn't matter whatever its value is. So both positive, that means in first quadrant. Okay, so this is again a way in which quadrant the given points will lie. Now about axis, so it is also possible, suppose point is given 0,7 or minus 3.2,0. Okay, basically you will get these two types of point. That means in short I can say 0, a, that is any real number, and a comma 0, that's it. These two points, that means if the coordinate of any one point is 0, if the coordinate of any one point is 0, then it might lie in either of the axes. Now if the x coordinate is 0, point will lie on y axis. If y coordinate is 0, point will lie on x axis. You can see, suppose if I say 2,0, where will mark it? 2 in this way and 0, that means first we move towards right and there is 0, so we can't move upwards. Okay, so point will lie on x axis. Okay, so any real number comma 0 on x axis, and 0 comma any real number, then point will be on y axis. So we can say on x axis y coordinate of the point will be 0, and on the y axis x coordinate of the point will be 0. In other words, on x axis ordinate will be 0 and on the y axis abscissa will be 0. Okay, so this is the one more way to ask the questions. Okay, now sometimes they do ask that to find the image of a point, okay, under the x axis or under the y axis. Now do you mean by the image of any point under the x axis and under the y axis? Let us see one example. Suppose we have to find the image of 2,3 under x axis. First of all, try to understand what is the meaning of under x axis. Under x axis means you have to consider the x axis as the mirror. Whenever we have to find image, the image we can find only if the mirror is there, isn't it? So when it is given find the image of any point under x axis, it means you have to consider the x axis as the mirror. Now if I locate point 2,3, this is point 2,3, x 2, y 3. Now you also I hope you also understand that image and the object of are at equal distance from the mirror. So here I am saying 2,3 is the object or the original coordinate. Now its image definitely will lie at the same distance from this mirror. Okay, it means I have to find the coordinate of this point. Now distance should be same, that means this must be equal to this. That means as this is equal to 3, this will be equal to 3. So here it is actually minus 3. So coordinate will be 2 comma minus 3. So here we are getting one rule that image of any point A comma B under x axis will be A comma minus B. That means what we have to do, if we have to find the image of any point under x axis, we'll interchange the sign of y coordinate. And when we have to find the image of that point under y axis, we'll interchange the sign of its x coordinate. Okay, so you can take a note like this: image of A comma B under x axis is A comma minus B. I simply interchange the sign of y coordinate, or instead of A comma B you can write x comma minus x comma y. So here it will become x comma y. And image of again x comma y under y axis will be minus x comma y. Okay, so this is all about chapter, that is coordinate geometry. Now next we will see Euclid geometry. Okay, there is nothing in the Euclid geometry. Everything is related to the theory only. So for that we'll discuss just one or two things, and remaining you will get in the form of PDF. You have to just go through that PDF, MCQs will be there, and that will be sufficient. Okay, so only thing over here in Euclid geometry that we are going to see, Euclid geometry. So very first thing, it has some axioms. Okay, it have some postulates, it have some definitions. Okay, so you have to go through all the axioms, postulates and definitions. What you have to learn, this chapter is almost related to the theory. So what you have to learn, that a set of axioms, so you should be able to identify. Suppose there are 15 statements are given, the only thing that you have to be able, that you should be identify that among those which are the axioms, which are the postulates and which are the definitions given by the Euclid. Okay, and especially in postulates you have to concentrate more on the fifth postulate. Okay, so you have to concentrate more on the fifth postulate. Now related also as it's theoretical subject, theoretical topic actually, so also you have to learn about that who was the student of whom, Pythagoras was a student of whom, Thales was the teacher of whom. All these things you have to learn by heart. So related to this you will get a PDF. Go through that PDF, and that is sufficient for this Euclid geometry. Now next we will see is probability. Okay, next we will see is the probability. That is also a very small chapter, probability. Okay, it is also, I won't say it's a theoretical topic, but the basic thing in this that you should understand, the very basic formula. Probability of any event is number of favorable outcomes, number of favorable outcomes upon total number of outcomes, upon total number of outcomes. That is the formula that we'll use throughout this particular chapter. Okay, now other than this, what you have to learn in the theoretical portion, that probability of any event is always greater than equal to 0 and less than equal to 1. That means probability of any event cannot be less than 0, cannot be greater than 1. Either it will be equal to 1 or less than 1, either it will be greater than 0 or equal to 0. Or the same thing can be written as probability of any event is always greater than equal to 0% and less than equal to 100%. Okay, it also says that probability of any event cannot be negative. Okay, also when I say probability of any event cannot be lies between 0 and 1, that means it might be 0, it might be 1. So in what cases it will be 0, in what cases it will be 1? See, whenever the probability will be 0, we'll say the event is impossible. For example, probability of getting 7 on a throw of dice, it is impossible because the dice have only 6 number from 1 to 6. So we cannot get 7 on a single throw of a dice, of a single throw of a single dice. Okay, it is not possible to get 7. Now probability, the event is called impossible event. Okay, impossible event. Okay, impossible event P of E equal to 0. Now probability of a sure event that definitely will happen, probability of getting a number less than 7 of a throw of a dice, definitely it will be less than 7. Might be it 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 or 6, definitely it will be less than 7. So that is called the sure event, and for sure event probability is equal to 1. One more thing, probability of happening of any event and probability of not happening of that event is 1. Okay, this is the next point, probability of happening of that event and probability of not happening of the same event is always equal to 1. Okay, so now we'll see some questions based on probability. Let me give you some questions. So let us see. Okay, so we'll see questions related to suppose a number is selected. We talk about a dice only. A dice is thrown and we have to find the probability of getting even number. Okay, probability of even number. Okay, probability of odd number. Probability of composite number. Okay, probability of prime of 6. Okay, so it's not a difficult task. See, now there is a one more word associated with the probability, that is called sample space. Sample space, that means set of all the possible outcomes. Whatever possibles are possible associated to that event is called the sample space. For example, if we throw a dice, then 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. This is the sample space. That means it is a possible that we'll get 1, we'll get 2, 3, 4, 5, or 6. Okay, so this is the sample space. Now, for even number, we have to find the probability of even number. So, how many even numbers are there? 2, 4, and 6. There are 3 even numbers. So, we'll say number of favorable outcome, that is 3. Number of total outcomes, that is 6. So, probability will be 1 by 2. Okay, I'm not solving in a complete way because we are revising this chapter. So, I hope you know how to write in a fixed format. Just I'm giving you an idea. So, probability of getting even number is 1 by 2. Probability of odd number, again it is 1 by 2 because there are 3 odd numbers. Probability of composite number. Now, composite number, first of all, you should know what is composite number. Composite numbers are numbers which have more than 2 factors. So, this is composite number and this. There are only 2 composite numbers over here. So, 2 upon 6, that is, this is the solution of, this is the answer of this second one. This is first one, this is second one. Third one is 2 by 6, that is 1 by 3. And prime factor of 6. Okay, I wrote prime of 6. Actually, it is prime factor of 6. Now, prime factor of 6 are 2 and 3. Or if I write factor of 6, then it will be 1, 2, 3, 4, 6. 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4, and 6. If I say prime factors of 6, so probability will be 2 by 6, that is 1 by 3. If I say factor of 6, then probability will be 4 by 6, because if I talk about factor of 6, so 1 is also a factor, 6 is also a factor. Okay, so be alert, factors of 6 is different thing, prime factor of 6 is different thing. Okay, so this is the one of the example. Now let us see one more example. Okay, now one another example. Suppose there is a telephone directory and a page number is one of the number is selected at random, then what is the probability that its unit digit will be this and that and so on base. So that is again similar to the this question only. Okay, if we select a number at random, what is the possibility of unit digit? What are the possible outcomes? We can get a unit digit at 0, we can get unit digit as 1 up to 9, isn't it? These are the possible outcomes when we select a number at random. So these are the possible outcome that we may get one of the digit at the unit digit. Okay, so now the question might be asked in that way, that find the probability that the selected number has unit digit as 3 or has unit digit less than 3. So let us see some question related to this unit digit. Okay, is multiple of 3. Less than 5. Okay. At most 6. Okay. Prime number. At least 7. Okay, so question is that if a number is selected at random from a directory, what is the possibility that the unit digit of the selected number is multiple of 3, less than 5, at most 6, prime number, at least 7. So here total outcomes are how much? 10. From 0 to 9, so total outcomes are 9. Okay. Now, multiple of 3, so among 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 and 9, this is the multiple of 3, this is the multiple of 3, this is the multiple of 3. So there are 3 outcomes which are favorable to this event. So probability will be 3 upon 10. Okay, over here, less than 5, so when I say less than 5, that means 0 to 4. So probability is 5 by 10. Now, at most 6. That means at the max it should be 6. 6. Okay. Maximum it should be 6. Not more than 6. Okay. At most that means either 6 or less than 6. Isn't it? Either 6 or less than 6. That means all these. That means leaving these 3 behind, remaining all. So out of 10, we skip 3, 7 upon 10. Okay, prime number. Now among these you have to find the prime number. So 2 is a prime, 3 is a prime, 5 is a prime, 7 is a prime. That's it. That is 4 upon 10. Okay, at least 7, that means minimum 7 must be there, not less than 7. That means 7 or more than 7. Okay, at least 7, that means minimum 7 should be there. If it is less than 7, we won't consider. So 7 or more than 7, that means 7, 8, 9. So 3 by 10. So this is the way to find the probabilities for these events. Okay, so now let us see one more example and then we'll come to the next chapter. Okay, and let me take one more example from the probability. Okay, however, I should not discuss this, but let us discuss the coin tossed. Okay, I will discuss in very short. If a coin is tossed 500 times, okay, if a coin is tossed 500 times, okay, head came 150 times and tail came, but obvious, 350 times. What is the probability of each event? So 150 upon 500, 350 upon 500. So I won't discuss this much. Now, next thing that I will discuss, suppose two coins are tossed simultaneously. Okay, two coins are tossed simultaneously. Okay, so definitely possible outcomes are that you will get head on both. Okay, you may get head on first, tail on second, tail on first, head on second, and tail on both. These are the possible outcomes. Now suppose two coins are tossed for a while, I'm saying 100 times. Here I got two heads, suppose 26 times. Okay, here I got, this is 35 times, this I got 15 times, and this I got 24. Okay, now the question comes like that, what is the probability of getting all heads? So all heads, that means 26 upon 100. Okay, what is the probability of getting two tails? That means 24 upon 100. What is the probability of getting one head? So it is one head, so I have to include these two. So probability of getting one head is 50 upon 100. Okay, so this is the way by which we can find the probability for these type of questions. Okay, now one more question, let's discuss. Suppose a question comes like this, that there is a bag and that bag contains, okay, 5 red balls, okay, 7 blue balls, okay, 3 green balls, and 4 white balls. Okay, now what is the probability? Now one ball is taken out at random from this bag. What is the probability of getting black ball? What is the probability of getting black ball? So no black ball is in the bag, so probability will be zero. It's a impossible event. If the ball is that of that color is not inside the bag, it is not possible to take it out. Okay, what is the probability of getting blue balls? So probability of getting blue ball will be 7 upon sum of these. How many balls are in the bag? So 7 plus 3, 10, and 5 plus 4, 19. So 7 upon 19 is the probability of getting a blue ball. Okay, so this type of question you may get in the exam. Okay, now after probability, now we'll come to the next chapter, that is Heron's formula. This particular chapter based on only one formula, Heron's formula. So that formula, this formula first of all is used to find the area of the triangle. Okay, area of the triangle, Heron's formula. So suppose we have a triangle and its sides are given, then the formula to find the area is S minus A, S minus B, S minus C. Actually, root over S minus A, S minus B, S minus C. Now, what is S? S over here is semi-perimeter. S is semi-perimeter. Name itself says semi means half. Perimeter is sum of sides. So, S is actually A plus B plus C by 2. Okay, semi-perimeter. So, okay, so there are again two or three types of questions in this particular chapter. At first, directly you will get the values of the sides of the triangle and you have to find the its area. Okay. Okay, another type of question can be given, that this ratio of the sites will be given to you and its perimeter will be given to you, and they will ask you to find the area of the equilateral triangle. So first I am writing that ABC is given directly. Second I am writing A is to B is to C and perimeter is given. Okay. Third, it is given triangle is isosceles. Okay. And one and the non-equal side is given. That means I can say you have the information that isosceles triangle is there. Okay. Any one side is given and the perimeter is given. Okay, basically these three types of questions are there in this particular chapter. There is one more question in which they do ask to find the area of a trapezium, and over there we need this concept. So first we'll see one example of these three and then we come to that question. Okay, formula you have to remember, it is a plus b plus semi perimeter is a plus b plus c by 2 and area of triangle is root over s minus a, s minus b, s minus c. So very first question, suppose sides are 9, 12 and 15. Okay, 9, 12 and 15 are the sides. So I will say a equal to 9, b equal to 15, c is equal to 12. So s will be 9 plus 15 plus 12 by 2. Okay, so we can find the semi-perimeter, that will be 36 by 2. Okay, that is 18. Okay, so area I can write S, that is 18, then 18 minus A, that is 9, then 18 minus B, that is 15, then 18 minus C, that is 12, root over. Okay, so this will be 18 into 9 into 3 into 6. Maximum of you what do after this, you start multiplying. Okay, no need to multiply over here because you have to find a square root, and to find a square root, even though if you multiply, after multiplication you are going to find its factor. So better to find the factors here only. See, this 18 and this is again 18. I will directly take out 18 outside the root sign. Only 9 is there and I know root 9 is 3. So here I will do right 3. That is 54. Centimeter square or meter square or unit square, whatever is given in the question. So this is the first type of question. Now second type, in which you will get the ratio of the sides as well as the perimeter of the triangle. So suppose ratio is 12 is to 17 is to 25. Okay, ratio of the sides A is to B is to C is 12 is to 17 is to 25. 12 is to 17 is to 25. Also it is given perimeter is equal to, perimeter is 540 is the perimeter. So as the ratio is given, I can say A equal to 12x, B is equal to 17x, C is equal to 25x. Also perimeter is 540, that means I can say sum of these three, that means 12x plus 17x plus 25x is equal to 540, isn't it? So this gives you 54x is equal to 540, x is equal to 10. Now as soon as I got x equal to 10, I will be able to get the measure of ABC. So I can say A is equal to 120, B is equal to 170 and C is equal to 250. Now after getting this, now next I am going to find semi perimeter. Now for semi perimeter, definitely we know A plus B plus C by 2, that means half of perimeter, but here already I have the perimeter, then I won't add this. I simply make half of the perimeter which is given directly to me, that is 550 by 2, that is 270. Now I have S, A, B, C. Now next is I have to put these values in the formula. Okay, so this was the second type of question. Okay, now third. Okay, here A, B, C and S is there. So I am hoping that you will be able to find it by your own, just by keeping the values in the formula. Now next, you will get an isosceles triangle, okay, and the perimeter. So now isosceles triangle, so each of equal side, it is given perimeter of the triangle is 30 and each of equal side, each of equal side is 12. That is, I can say what we have: A equal to 12, B equal to 12, P equal to 30. Now to get the area of triangle, what I need extra, it's semi-perimeter and the third side. Okay, so as the perimeter is given, I can find S directly, it will be 15, but obvious half of this. Even though I do not have the value of C, I can get the value of S because perimeter is given. Now how to get the third side? So it's very simple, A plus B plus C is equal to P. That is 12 plus 12 plus C is equal to 30. So C is equal to 30 minus 24, so C is equal to 6. So here again I can say I have all three things which I need to find the area of triangle A, B, C and S. So again I will put these values in the formula to get its area. Okay, now next, that I told you that one of the little bit different question in which they ask you to find the perimeter, let me explain one or two more question. Sometimes they do ask if the sides of triangle are increased by same percent or doubled or tripled, then what will be the change in the area. Okay, so let me take a question. If it is given the find, you have to find the percentage change if each side is made double. If each side of a triangle is made double, then what will be the percentage change in its area? Suppose that we have to find. So initially we have sides A, B and C. Okay, and area we have S, S minus A, S minus B, S minus C, isn't it? Now they are saying that sides has been doubled. So what will be the new sides? 2A. Okay, I'm directly writing new sides will be 2A, 2B and 2C, isn't it? These are the new sides. So what will be new semi-perimeter? This will be 2A plus 2B plus 2C by 2. That is, I can write, if I take in this way 2 common, A plus B plus C by 2. Okay, that means I can write this is S by 2, isn't it? Sorry, 2S. This quantity is semi-perimeter, isn't it? A plus B plus B C by 2. And twice of, that means new perimeter will be double of the original perimeter. Now we'll see new area. So new area will be at the place of this semi-perimeter. I have to put new semi-perimeter, that is S dash minus 2A, S dash minus 2B, S dash minus 2C, root over. Okay, so A dash is equal to, now S dash is 2S, okay, so 2S minus 2A, here again 2S minus 2B, here again 2S minus 2C, isn't it? Now this A dash, now I can take 2 common from all these three brackets and this 2, so this gives me 2 multiplied by 2 multiplied by 2, and then S, S minus A, S minus B, S minus C. Okay, so A dash is equal to, now this is 16, that is 4, and you can see this S, S minus A can be replaced by A. So new area is equal to 4 times. So if they are asking by how many times new area will be, the answer will be 4, but they are asking percentage change. So that I know, percentage is equal to final minus initial upon initial into 100. So 4A is the final, A was the initial, upon initial into 100. So 3A upon A into 100, that is 300%. Okay, so simply in short, I can say it will increase by 300%. Now one thing more, here they asked, make it double, then what will be changed? So if you observe, 3 is 2 square minus 4. That means if they say that the sides are made triple, then percentage change will be 3 square minus 1 multiplied by 100. Okay, if each side of the triangle is made 3 times, then percentage change will be 3 square minus 1 multiplied by 100, that is 800%. If it is made 4 times, then answer will be 4 square minus 1 multiplied by 100. Okay, so this was the one of the important concept of this particular chapter. Okay, now we'll see one more question. In short, we'll see that I told you that if the okay, the question is something like that, that parallel sides of the trapezium are given. Okay, parallel sides are given 25 and 13. Okay, and non-parallel sides are given 15 and 15. And you have to find the area of the trapezium. Now, first of all, to get the area of trapezium, what you need? Its formula, which is 1 upon 2 A plus B into H, area of trapezium. Okay, sum of parallel sides, distance between parallel sides. So here sum of parallel sides we have 13 and 25, so we can add them. What we do not have, distance between these two parallel sides. So let us see how to find. Now over here we need what? Hilbert formula. For that, some first of all we have to make some constructions. Suppose I draw a line parallel to this, let me name it ABCD. Okay, and let me take this point as Q. So first of all I draw CQ, which is parallel to DA. Now it is already given that DC and AQ are parallel because DC and AB are parallel. I took CQ parallel AD, so this makes this quadrilateral as a parallelogram, and in a parallelogram opposite sides are equal. So as this was 15, this will become 15. Okay, now this complete side is 25, and just right now I proved it's a parallelogram. That means this AQ will be equal to this DC, isn't it? That means this AQ will be 13 and the whole length was 25, so but obvious remaining will be 12. Okay, I'm repeating once again, I took CQ parallel DA, which makes AQCD is a parallelogram. As soon as I got it a parallelogram, I took DC equal to AQ, so DC 13, so AQ become 13. Now this complete length was 25, this much is 13, so but obvious remaining will be 12. Also this AD equal to CQ because it's a parallelogram, so this 15, so this will 15. Now here I got a triangle, I can find its area by Heron's formula. Okay, its area when I will find will be 18 root 21. Okay, area of BCQ will be 18 root 21. When you find with the help of Heron's formula, you will get this area. Now this area I can compare, say this is the height h and this is the base, so I can say BCQ is equal to 1 upon 2 base BQ and height h 18 root 21. Okay, here BQ is given to us, this is 12, so 1 upon 2 into 12 into h is equal to 18 root 21. So from this you will get the value of h, and as soon as you get h, that means height of this trapezium, you will be able to find its area. Okay, so this was the something a little bit we can say application of the Heron's formula. So here I am finishing this lecture. Now in next lecture we'll see the revision of some more chapters. Till then, bye. Thank you. Take care.